Good morning, and welcome to Redeemer Lutheran Church. I'm Pastor Gary Lode Holt. We are talking about music this week, and before I dig into today's topic, yesterday I mentioned that when I was in Israel, the thing I brought back for myself was a shofar, or ram's horn that they used as a trumpet, somewhat like that. And I got some requests to show it, and so here you can see the my shofar that I have in my home. And if you'll bear with me, because I'm not very good at this, because I, of course, never practice, but I'll blow it so you can hear what it sounds like as well. May take a couple of times, but here we go. So that wasn't so bad. Got it on the first shot. So, now to today's message. From time to time, I like to use these morning moments with you to highlight obscure or little-known people from the Bible story. I try to show you that God works through those who don't grab the biblical headlines as well, and in so doing, I hope to encourage you that God does work through you and the ministry you offer to those around you. It's a worthy cause, and I'm going to introduce you to one of those obscure characters right now, and I doubt you've ever paid attention to him or noticed him. His name is Jubal, and he is mentioned in only one verse in the Bible. Genesis 4:21 says, "His brother's name was Jubal. He was the ancestor of all those who play the lyre and the pipe." That's it. The Bible is going through a list of Cain's descendants, and then it mentions Jubal, and those who study the Bible believe it means that Jubal invented music. At the very least, he invented stringed instruments and something like a flute or oboe. Since the organs we use in church worship services rely on pipes that have air forced through them, we owe the music in our worship to Jubal as well. So, last week was something of a jubilee here at Redeemer as we hosted summer music camp. About 50 elementary-aged kids came each day for a morning of singing, drumbeat rhythm training, art, handbells, story time, and more. The jubilee in their hearts was easy to see by their constant smiles that they had on their faces. So by the way of saying thanks to Jubal, I'm spending this week with you by looking at music in the Bible and considering the heritage, the instruments, and the history as the story of music accompanied the story of salvation. Today we want to begin with cymbals. Now, when I mention cymbals, most of us probably have in mind the cymbals we see as part of an orchestra or even on modern drum sets. However, in most circumstances in the Bible, the cymbals referred to are much smaller, something like castanets or finger cymbals. Again, most often used by women, they often accompanied some sort of dance or praise during worship. For example, when the Ark of the Covenant was being returned to Israel after being captured by the Philistines, 2 Samuel 6 tells us that as it entered Jerusalem, David and all the house of Israel were dancing before the Lord with all their might, with songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. In other words, as they danced in celebration, cymbals were part of it. The Psalms refer to praising God with sounding cymbals, even loud clashing cymbals, so they must have had large ones too. St. Paul does speak of cymbals in a negative way in his famous chapter on love in 1 Corinthians 13 when he says, "If I do not have love, I am a noisy gong or clanging cymbal." The sound of a cymbal can be harsh, but at times it can be just the right thing. Our next musical instrument to consider is the bell. My grandson was attending music camp this past week, and part of what they are learning is about the handbells. When I asked him after his first day what he thought about it all, he loved it, but he said, "The bells were loud." I don't think the bells they used in the Bible were particularly loud, however. When the Hebrews were set free from slavery in Egypt, one of the things they did was to create a place to worship God. Since it needed to be movable with them, they built a tabernacle, which was a tent of meeting. And the feature of this tent that was later followed in the design of the temple was an established building when they got to Jerusalem, was what they called the Holy of Holies, or the Most Holy Place. This area was shielded off by heavy curtains from all the rest of the tabernacle, and inside was the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark was considered to be the footstool of God, under God's very throne. That meant this was the touch point of God with earth. The very presence of God was there, which is why it was so holy. The rules of worship said that only the high priest could enter this area, and then only on one day a year, on the Day of Atonement, celebrating our need for and the gift of God's forgiveness. Interestingly, the word atonement can be split up into at-one-ment, our opportunity to be at one with God again. Anyway, when the high priest entered the Holy of Holies, no one else could be in there with him. There was concern that in being so close to the presence of God, the high priest might be overcome and faint, or perhaps even die. So, when the high priest went into the Holy of Holies, a rope was tied around his waist so that if he were overcome, they could pull him out without entering the Holy of Holies themselves. And how were they to know if he had been overcome? They attached bells to the hem of his robe so that they would tinkle as he moved about, signaling that he was okay and still moving. If the bells fell silent, then they knew there was a problem. This is all spelled out in Exodus 28, and while it doesn't describe the bells used as music, it's nice to think about the gentle melodic tinkle that accompanied the high priest entering into the very presence of God. Many church organs, including ours here at Redeemer, have a stop called a zimbalstern, and sometimes they are even visible so that you can see it in action. The word is German for zimbalstar, and it is a circle of bells and a clapper that rotates and strikes each one. It provides a pleasant, celebratory, jangly ring to the music, and I think from now on, whenever I hear it, I will think about the high priest entering into the presence of God and realize anew that in worship, I am right then in the very presence of God. Thanks, Jubal. Your gift of music touches our hearts even now. Thanks for watching, and remember to let this day belong to God.